here already to join in this. Mrs. LVS, LV Subramanian, I request you to join us, please.
Bala Subram Yaganya Shri Chidananganata Varenya Ashi Bala Subram Manya Gragnyashi Chidanata Swami Shailastita Somatata Sadi Sanduta Swami Nata Swami Shailastita Somatata Kanakavalli Devata Varenya Ashri Babu Brahmanya
Thank you very much, children. Please wait. I request the chief guest to please honor the children who sang the prayers. இதல நான் உங்களை எல்லாம் இன்வைட் பண்ணதுக்கு ரொம்ப சந்தோஷப்படுறேன். இன்னைக்கு வந்து இட் இஸ் ஹேப்பன் டு பி ஃபுல் மூன் டே. இன்னைக்கு வந்து கோவிலுக்கு போல நிறையா பேருக்கு இங்கே வந்ததுனால அந்த வருத்தமே பட வேண்டாம். பிகாஸ் இன்னைக்கு வந்து வி ஆர் கோயிங் டு ஹேவ் அ பில்கிரிமேஜ் ஆஃப் தீக்ஷிதர் ஃப்ரம் யூ. இங்கே எல்லா ஊருக்கும் ஆட்சியம் பெற போகிறான் நம்மளை. ஸோ கண்ணை மூண்டு உட்காந்துட்டு இருந்தால் போகிறோம். நல்ல ஏசியில் சாப்பாடும் இருக்குது. மத்தியானம் சாப்பிட்டுட்டு இப்படி ஆனந்தமான தியானத்தை பண்ணுறதுக்கு ஒரு சான்ஸ் கிடச்சிருக்கு நமக்கெல்லாம். அண்ட் ஐ இன்வைட் அவர் ஹானரபிள் சீஃப் கெஸ் அண்ட் வி ஹாவ் அ
டு ஸ்ரீ லேட் அரியக்குடி ராமானுஜயர். தி இன்சைட்ஸ் ஆஃப் சாங் ஹி டுக் ஒன் அண்ட் ஹாஃப் ஹவர்ஸ் டு எக்ஸ்பிளைன் டு அரியக்குடி அண்ட் தி குடி கோஸ் He was so moved by that song, Paramacharya ended up singing that song and telling how the song was and explained the importance of diction when you try to sing people in this world, because amidst the din of noise in current affairs, we need a Sri Rama out of the high value of our culture and tradition, because people, the easiest thing people feel is to forget about history. We are here because of the history. So I think I...
Tsavalu, we have been having demonstrative lectures, speeches, rendition of all the great Vagyakaras. And the lecture on Muthuswami Dikshitar has in fact given us a phenomenal understanding of the contribution of Muthuswami Dikshitar. It's a great opportunity for all the Indians, actually, not so much as we all call, is a repository of all such discovery. And it's that minute you are out of the precincts, you are again worried about, you know, how to make a fast buck or how to get a promotion or how to do something else. So I think that is how we are all in a day of having an opportunity to at least the future, as we see today when oxygen levels are coming down, we see the environmental degradation
is safe and protected from the invasions and the disturbances that were happening up north. Having come to the south, he begins learning music, and his music, the biography also says that he lost his parents within 6 months of each other, and so probably at a very early age he was orphaned. In Kamalalayam, you have already attained mukti. But you must go and visit it at least once. Ekam Ramaswamy Dikshitar has codified the meaning. Neither party knew the language of the other party. So the Dubash was the only man who knew what the other man was saying. So the Dubashes naturally became very, very rich. And they controlled private armies. They were actually gang lords over a period of time. Though today we consider many of these Dubashes to be great patrons of the art, they also had a reasonably villainous background to their life, which is not very well documented. But Manali Muthukrishna Mudali, more so than several others, by the time he was more or less owning most of the Thanjavur area, for which he had been given a rent contract by the East India Company. That is, he would be farmed out the fields over there, he would employ farmers, and they would pay him a kisht, which in turn he would pass on after deducting his commission to the East India Company. So he was extremely well-to-do, and he arrives in Tiruvarur, and having seen Ramaswamy Dikshitar perform, is so impressed that he tells him that you come with me to Madras, I will take you to the great capital city. See, by the time, Thanjavur is in a phase of decline, because repeatedly the Arcot Nawabs have come and invaded Thanjavur in order to conquer it. The British have been protecting the Thanjavur kingdom to a certain extent. Then by the 1780s, Hyder Ali and Tipu Sultan have come and have laid waste the entire region following their policy of slash and burn. It is said that 50,000 people died in the invasion of Tipu Sultan and Hyder Ali in 1780. Several children were taken away and converted forcibly to Islam. So there was a lot of uncertainty in that region. So Ramaswamy Dikshitar very shrewdly decides that he should go away to Madras, which is a relatively safe capital. And so they come here under the protection of Manali Muthukrishna Mudali, and this is where they live. Of Ramaswamy Dikshitar, it is said that every Ekadashi he would sing the Jayadeva Gita Govindam in full. He was also, as we know, the creator of the Hamsadhvani Raga. Now, while they are living in Madras, they have a series of visitors, because Muthukrishna Mudali was no ordinary man. People would come. So prior to the arrival of Ramaswamy Dikshitar, both Mariamutta Pillai and Arunachala Kavirayar have come to Madras and have sung in the presence of Manali Muthukrishna Mudali and collected rich gifts and gone back. So they are Manali Muthukrishna Mudali, and after he dies, his son Venkatakrishna Mudali, who is known as Chinnayan, these are the two people who are the big patrons of the art over here, along with several other Dubashes. So at that time, they have a yogi who comes home. His name is Chidambaranatha Yogi. This Chidambaranatha Yogi, when he comes to stay in Muthukrishna Mudali's house, Dikshitar is probably assigned the task of taking care of the yogi, who is greatly impressed with this young boy. And he says that when he goes to Kashi, he would like to take this boy along with him. By the time Dikshitar is already married, he has had two wives. And so along with both his wives, he travels to Kashi. A journey to Kashi is something that, you know, we cannot imagine how they would have travelled. Because a good 30 years or a good 20 years after Dikshitar, Sharaboji travels to Kashi. Sharaboji, the last ruler of Thanjavur. And he is a reigning Maharaja. So you can imagine the amount of arrangements and bandobas that must have been done for him to travel to Kashi. He was also a close friend of the East India Company. By the time the East India Company had conquered the whole country, so everything was safe. Still, it took 3 months for Sharaboji to reach Banaras. Imagine this Chidambaranatha Yogi, who probably had only one kamandalu and some ochre robes in his possession. And then this young man and his two wives, they must have probably walked all the distance, or they must have struggled through a lot of enemy territory, lot of insurrection on the way, dacoits, bandits, which is why in those days it was believed that those who went to Kashi never ever came back. Dikshitar travels with his guru, spends 5 years in Banaras, and there he is initiated into the Sri Vidya form of worship by Chidambaranatha Yogi, practices his music, and at the end of 5 years, according to Subrahma Dikshitar, takes leave of his guru and returns to Madras with his two wives. Somewhere along the line, he must have acquired his Veena, which is still available with the family today in Coimbatore, that is where they live. It's a very tiny instrument. It is not the standard Thanjavur Veena that we see today. It is very difficult to imagine how he would have produced his famous gamakams on that little instrument. And the yali faces upwards instead of downwards,
And on the kodam you have the word Sri Rama written in Devanagari. This is the identification of the Muthuswami Dikshitar Vine. I don't know where he would have acquired it, but he does have it, and then he comes back to Madras. During the time that he has been away, there have been other visitors in the Manali family. One of them is Govinda Dikshitar, one of the descendants of Venkatamakin, who wrote the Chaturdandi Prakashika. Now, Ramaswami Dikshitar and Manali Venkatakrishna Mudali know that that man is carrying the Chaturdandi Prakashika with him in the form of a manuscript. And they are very keen to acquire the manuscript from him. So Muthukrishna Mudali asks him, saying that I would like to have your manuscript from you. That man says, I will sing a raga for you. If you are able to identify this raga for me, I will believe that you are worthy of acquiring this manuscript and I will hand it over to you. So he sings the Murchana of a raga, which Manali Muthukrishna Mudali, Venkatakrishna Mudali and Ramaswami Dikshitar, they act as though, you know, even the small children in the family can identify what this raga is. So young Chinnaswami and Baluswami are asked to sing. Nannu Parikshin Chayela, is this worthy of, if am I to be examined like this in the raga Tanukirti? Having sung that, immediately that man is delighted. He says, yes, you are also part of the, he is practicing the Shodashakshari mantra and climbing up the steps. When, as Subrahma Dikshitar writes, Lord Chengalvaraya, that is Subramanya Swami himself in the form of an old man, arrived, asked Muthuswami Dikshitar to open his mouth, put sugar candy in it and went away. And the moment he had that experience, he burst into song. This is as given in Subrahma Dikshitar himself. So the first song, Shri Nathati Guru Guho Jayati, there itself everything about Dikshitar is given. It's a Sanskrit song with fantastic alliteration. You know, imagine us being asked to write a letter for the first time in our lives. How many times we must have deleted and looked into Google and seen if there is something cut and paste that we can do, and so on and so forth. This man, his first work itself is so perfect. The alliteration, the prosody, the raga name is incorporated into the song. There is high flowing Sanskrit and the structure of the song, Shri Nathadi Guru Guho Jayati, in the Pallavi itself, you have the slow speed, the middle speed and the fast speed. And the entire swara pattern of the song is in the form of a palindrome. So he had shown that he had arrived in this world by means of just that one composition. And notwithstanding that, he went on to compose 7 other songs on Guru. All of them being known as the Guru Guha Vibhakti Kirtanas, of which Shri Nathati Guru Guho Jayati is the first. What is very interesting is that those 8, and assuming that he would have composed them at the same time or probably over a period, they have a certain difficulty for normal comprehension in terms of the lyrics, which probably no other compositions of his have. It is very difficult to interpret what he is talking about. Definitely it is not the Subramanya Swami who is sitting in Tirthani. It is of a mystic guru of very high philosophy. And it almost appears as though that the rest of his songs, he kind of mixed common stories and interesting facts so that people like us would get interested in his songs and not dismiss them as high philosophy which is beyond our comprehension. Having started off as a composer, you can't stop this personality. So he then comes back to Madras, by which time Tanjavur has become relatively peaceful. Saraboji has become the king and in 1 year has completely willed his kingdom away to the British to become a pensioner. And Chinnayan or Venkatakrishna Mudali is dying. So there is no patron in Madras. So Ramaswami Dikshitar wants to go back to Tiruvarur. So he and his wife depart while the boys stay on here. When they get an invitation from Upanishad Brahmam in Kanchipuram. Upanishad Brahmam was a great saint who lived almost to the age of 100. In 1837, 2 years after Muthuswami Dikshitar died, Upanishad Brahmam was still living. And he sends an invitation to Tyagaraja, who then comes to Kanchipuram to stay with Upanishad Brahmam for a brief while. So Dikshitar goes to Kanchipuram, stays with Upanishad Brahmam for 4 years, sets Upanishad Brahmam's Ramashtapadi to tune. You must remember his father was very familiar with the Jayadeva Ashtapadis. So Dikshitar probably had that experience, so he sets the Ramashtapadi to tune and then he travels around the Kanchipuram area. So not only does he compose songs on Kanchipuram temples, he goes to Sholingar where there is Narasimha Agacha on Narasimha and Pavanatmaja Agacha on Hanuman. Then he goes to Kalahasti, Sri Kalahastisha. Then he goes to Tirupati, Seshachalanayakam Bajami, Shankha Chakra Gadapanim, several songs. And if you look at just the Kanchipuram songs, take Chintaya Ma Kanda Moola Kandam for instance. Chintaya Ma Kanda Moola Kandam, Cheta Shri Somaskandam. Think of the Somaskanda who is at the root of the mango tree. Chintaya Ma Kanda, who is at the root of the mango tree and is the Moola Kanda, the primordial root of all creation. Even today during the Archana there, Ekambreshwara Swami is referred to as Mamoola Nathar. That expression has been incorporated by Muthuswami Dikshitar into his song. Chintaya Ma Kanda Moola Kandam Cheta Shri Somaskandam. And like this, for instance, in Sri Kalahastisha, Hina Jati Kirata Kena Pujita Bahukirte, about Kannappa Nayanar having come to that temple. These are the little facts and traditions that he brings in Shankha Chakra Gadapanim, Amritasara Bhakshanam. Amritasara Bhakshanam can mean he who is feasting on nectar. Amritasara is also the laddu. In Tirupati, was it the same thing? We have no idea. But this is the kind of interesting fact that Dikshitar incorporates into his songs. Sometime after having spent 4 years, we are probably looking at 1806 or 1807, he begins coming down south and travels to Chidambaram where he sings his Ananda Natana Prakasham. That one line, Bhusura Trisahasra Munishwaram. Even today, when the Dikshitars are fighting their court cases for trying to control the temple, they are citing the fact that they were one of 3,000 who came from the Himalayas, and with Shiva being one of the 3,000 himself. And that is the line that is incorporated in Ananda Natana Prakasha. Bhusura Trisahasra Munishwaram. The Lord of the 3,000 Brahmins who came. So he talks about that one fact in that song. So having travelled like this through Kanchi, Chidambaram and other places, Dikshitar comes to Tiruvarur where his parents are living and stays on there for a little while. For quite some time. Now during this time, he lavishes his love and affection on the various deities in the Tiruvarur temple. So Tiruvarur even today has the largest corpus of Muthuswami Dikshitar songs. There is of course the famous Kamalamba Nababarna Kirtanes, which uses the Sri Chakram as its basis, and there is the Dhyana Kirtane and the Mangala Kirtane. So there are 11 songs in all, but with the 9 intervening ones, each one of them describing one chakra in the Sri Chakram, starting from the outermost going up to the Bindu, which is the central point of the Sri Chakram. It is very interesting that the Bindu, which is supposed to be invisible to the human eye, has the biggest song in the Kamalamba Navavarna Kirtanes. And even the Thala structure, people like R.K. Shriram Kumar have said that it is the, even the number of beats in the song has got a certain mystic significance going back to the Sri Chakra in the Kamalamba Navavaranam. The iconography of the goddess, even in the beginning in Kamalambike in Todi, he says Vinoda Charane, because Kamalamba has got a certain iconography which no other goddess has in the whole of India. She is sitting cross-legged with one leg thrown on the other. So that is supposed to be a yogic posture, and he says Vinoda Charane, she of the unusual feet in his Kamalambike. And of course his Tyagaraja songs, there are the Tyagaraja Vibhakti Kritis as well, where he brings in a lot of the temple tradition into the Tyagaraja Vibhakti Kritis. So for instance, he talks about the Devadasi tradition. In one of them he says Vimala Rudra Ganika Nartana Priyena, because the Rudra Ganikas are the, Tiruvarur itself has got one of the, or had one of the most codified forms of Devadasi worship. So you had the Rudra Ganikas who were the highest Devadasis, and then you had the Kamalamba Dasis who were known as the Kondi Paramparai Dasis, and then so on and so forth till you came to the Manikathal who would actually be cleaning the temple and washing the vessels and all that. So he talks of the Rudra Ganikas who were worshipping in the shrine of Tyagesha. In his Uchishta Ganapatav, he talks about the very strange form of worship that is carried on in front of Uchishta Ganapati. Nagna Nari Ramakriya Modane, Nagna Nari Yoni Mukhaswadane. In that shrine, because it is fully tantric, he describes what is happening in that particular shrine. Nothing is hidden from Dikshitar, and he is wanting to tell us everything about this, these shrines that he has been to. Even the Nayanmar of Thiruvarur, Sundaramurthy Nayanar, is mentioned. Sundaramurthy Mashriyami in Takka is a song that is composed on Sundaramurthy, who is the Nayanar of Thyagesha. So Thyagesha idol is there at the end of the sanctum. At the opposite end, you will have Sundaramurthy Nayanar and his wife standing. When they do the Deeparadhane for Thyagesha, they will turn around and do the Deeparadhane for Sundaramurthy Nayanar as well. So he is the close friend of Thyagesha in that shrine. And then, because his father composed music for the temple, he composed Thyagaraja Mahadvajaroha in Sri Raga, which describes the entire Brahmotsavam of the temple. So, Shrishti Swarupa Vasanta Vaibhavam. So, starting from the float festival, he describes every event in the 10-day festival that goes on in the various Vahanams that come, and certain interesting traditions, Nijapada Darshanam, which I told you about. And he talks about Krishna Gandha Dharanam in one of the lines in that song. That is because on that particular day, the Dasi of the temple will apply a black paste on Thyagesha Swami to prevent the evil eye from falling on him. He is so beautiful that when he goes out, people will cast an evil eye on him. So they will apply a black paste on the idol. So Krishna Gandha Dharanam, that line will come in that song. Every tiny detail he packs in. He then travels around that area, so he composes songs at Nagapattinam, Krivelur, where Akshayalinga Vibho is composed. Dikshitar also obviously had a number of disciples by this time. And we have their names as well. So you have got Thirukkadaiyur Bharati. So Dikshitar goes to Thirukkadaiyur, probably because his disciple was there. And he composes Shankaram Abhirami Manoharam there in the Raga Manohari. He uses a line there. Yama Nigraha Anugraham, Bhayankara Ghora Rupadhara Yama Nigraha Anugraham. That is, Shiva kicks Yama to save Markandeya in that particular temple. So even now when you go to worship in that temple, you have a huge Utsavamurti of Shiva. And they will remove a panel from the base and show you, and they'll show that Yama is lying dead at the foot of Shiva. So they'll say, this is Yama Nigraham. So they will, Yama Nigraha Taparungo. So you will have to worship. Then immediately they'll ask you to turn back, and there'll be a standing figure of Yama over there. The legend is that if Yama was killed, there was no death in the world. Everybody was living. So Shiva had to resurrect Yama. So they'll say, Yama Nigraha Tapatutu Yama Anugrahata Ninga Pakanopo. So the same line, Bhayankara Ghora Rupadhara Yama Nigraha Anugraham, is included. You know, he must have heard this line being used when he went to that particular temple. And he kind of refers to it in the same song. So he, Thirukkadaiyur Bharati is one of his disciples. He goes to Mayavaram because two of his disciples appear to have come from that area. Thereindur, which is not in Mayavaram but some distance away. And Vallalar Kovil Ammani, who was a Devadasi, she appears to have also come from that area. So he follows. Sometimes you find that he has gone to several villages from which his disciples had come from. And in Thiruvarur itself, he had a few disciples. So you had Thiruvarur Ayyasami Natuvanar. You had Dasi Kamalam, who was of the Kondi Parampara. She used to dance in front of Kamalambal. And you had Shuddhamathalam Thambiya Papile. What is very interesting is, you find that this orthodox Brahmin Dikshitar did not believe in the caste system. Most of his disciples were Nagaswara Vidwans, Natuvanars, Devadasis and Madalam artists. I don't have to tell you that in that particular point of time, or rather till 1900 or 1940, the Nagaswaram artist was considered to be of the most backward community, and they wouldn't even allow him to come inside. He would have to stand outside, stand and play bare-chested. It was the Nagaswaram artist who fought for self-respect, and then they were given a certain status in society. This Dikshitar in the 19th century was beyond all this, and he was happily going around with these musicians, not adhering to the caste tradition. So he was probably far ahead of his time, far evolved, and did not believe in any of this. So having taught music here for some time, in 1817 he loses his father, and then it is time for the family to move once again. By then, Tanjavur under Sharaboji has become a cultural heartland. So leaving Thiruvarur, Muthuswami Dikshitar goes to Tanjavur, where he is ordained to teach music to four very talented children. The eldest born in 1802, the youngest born in 1810. So we are looking at a group at four boys, 15 years at the most and 7 years at the least. Vadivelu, Chinnaya, Ponnaya and Sivanandam, the Tanjavur quartet, whose father is a famous Natuvanar in the Tanjavur court. So Dikshitar arrives, stays in West Main Street, becomes a very close friend of Shyama Shastri in the process. Along with his brothers, he has come there. And Shyama Shastri discovers that in the Dikshitar family, there is an incomplete Sriranjani Varnam composed by Ramaswami Dikshitar, the father, of which only the Pallavi, Anupallavi and one Chitta is available. So he says, why don't all of us sit down and complete it together? So the second Charanam is composed by Shyama Shastri, the third one by Muthuswami Dikshitar and the fourth one by Chinnaswami Dikshitar, and they complete the Varnam together. This is the kind of friendship the two great composers have had with each other. Now, teaching music to these four boys. Now, how do you get four children interested in music? Dikshitar comes up with a winning formula, which is what Chemmangudi used to always say. The aarambathla indha sharali jandaiyala vechi bore adikkiradhukku badhila chinna chinna paata kattu koduthu indha kuzhandhaiyila modhalla paattla Sita Rajan Mami is practicing it even now. And this is what Muthuswami Dikshitar did. He decided that the raganga ragas, that is the 72 ragas, had to be taught to these children. So he sets about composing small songs on the various shrines in Tanjavur. You have any number of temples in Tanjavur. And so he begins. So starting with Kanakambari Karunyamrita Lahari, which is in the first raga in Kanakambari, he goes on to Painadyuti and so on and so forth, till he comes to Rasamanjari, the 72nd, Shringara Rasamanjari, the last song, where he says, Dvisaptati Raganga Raga Modini. All the 72 ragas she delights in, thereby indicating that he has completed one major project in his lifetime. So you can almost imagine this Dikshitar taking these four boys like a picnic, going around to the various temples in the area, enjoying the day with them, teaching them a song in the middle, and getting them to slowly learn. And they became such stellar products of the Dikshitar school that they were eternally beholden to him. And a few songs of theirs mention this and say that we are the devotees of Guru Guha Swami. This is what they mention. Guru Guha Swami kine dasudai, that is what they say in Mayatita Swarupini, for instance. So having taught music to them, he also teaches Vadivelu the violin, because when Baluswami and Chinnaswami were in Madras, Manali Muthukrishna Mudali had them learn the violin from a band master in Fort St. George. So Dikshitar has to teach the violin to Vadivelu as well. And now, how do you teach the violin, which is a Western instrument with people standing and playing like this with a set of orchestral tunes? So he takes the orchestral tunes and writes Sanskrit lyrics for them. These are the Noteswara Sahityams of Muthuswami Dikshitar. So, God save our gracious queen, God save the noble queen, God save the queen. Santatam pahi mam sangeeta shyamale, sarvadhare janani sarvadhare. That is how he composes. Imagine, I mean, today when you look at this, you are so, you get horripilated, because you can't imagine this man sitting there and writing this kind of a lyric for an English tune. 48 tunes he writes the lyrics for. If at all today the violin is being practiced, is such an integral part of Carnatic music, it is because of what Muthuswami Dikshitar did. Then his little detailing of temples. I still have 10 minutes, I think. 10 minutes? Yeah. So his small detailing of temple traditions is something that I should tell you before I go on to the last phase in his life. The little known temples, almost like a GPS system, he'll tell you how to identify them. So near Tiruvarur, there is this unheard of village called Kulikkarai. And in Kulikkarai, there was a Vaidyalinga Mudaliyar who invited Muthuswami Dikshitar to come. Dikshitar goes there and composes a magnificent song, the Chaturdasha Ragamalika, Sri Vishwanatham Bhajeham. So he knows that later on in life, people like V. Sriram will come looking for this Kulikkarai and not find it. And if you ask people in Tiruvarur where is Kulikkarai, several people wouldn't know. So Sri Pura Niriti Bhaga Gartatira. Go to the northwestern direction of Tiruvarur and you will find Kulikkarai over there. So he is our GPS system, so to speak. So you go there and you realize that, you know, there is again this question, how did Dikshitar live? Surely he could not have eaten every day by composing songs and teaching a few disciples. Subrahma Dikshitar has the answer for that. He says the brothers regularly performed before patrons and kings. So they must have been honored in any case. Unlike his father, who used to compose straight away in the name of patrons, Dikshitar had a very dignified method of doing it. So his Vaidyalinga Mudaliyar invites him to Kulikkarai. So in Sri Vishwanatham Bhajeham, he includes a line, Vaidyalinga Bhupala Palanam. Take eternally protecting this Vaidyalinga, who is the Zamindar of this area. And in Kashi Vishweshwara Ehi, which is also composed on the same shrine, he goes a little further. Bhavaroga Hara Chatura Vaidyalinga Vibho. Oh Vaidyalinga, in the middle of a song on Kashi Vishweshwara, one clever line about Vaidyalinga, saying that, oh one who takes away the ills of this world. So he had done a Kanaka Abhishekam for Dikshita, probably, we don't know. Similarly, when he goes to Tanjavur, the big news in Tanjavur at that time is the Kumbhabhishekam that Sharaboji did for the Brihadishwarar temple. So in his Nabomani Chandragni Nayanam, Sharabendra Samsevita Charanam, one little line about the patron. No harm, doesn't matter. One human, good human being has been praised and protected. Similarly, in his Bhaktavatsalam, going back to the GPS system of Muthuswami Dikshitar, Bhaktavatsalam is on a temple called Tirukkannamangai, set in the Raga Vamshavati, one of the Divya Deshams. So there he says, Darsha Pushkarini Tata Paschima Bhagam, on the western side of the Darsha Pushkarini. So you shouldn't lose your way, you will find the temple. So you go there. I went there a few years ago in the middle of pouring rain. So this song is a wealth of description about, see, where he doesn't have too many other details to give, he packs in a lot of local description and local color into the song. So in this song he says Vishala Vedasagara Mantapam. So you go inside and you keep looking for this Vedasagara Mantapam. Then a priest comes and tells you, this is the Vedasagara Mantapam where you are standing. There are four pillars: Rigvedata Gurutun, Samavedata Gurutun, Yajurvedata Atharvavedata Gurutun. So it's called Vedasagara Mantapam, Lakshmi Vivahotsavam. And then in the last line, Suramaya Madhumakshikaraditam. If you go to the Thayar Sannadhi, Abhishekavalli Shrine in Bhaktavatsala Perumal Kovil, there is a beehive. That beehive has been there from time immemorial. It is believed that the gods came to worship, witness the wedding of Vishnu with Lakshmi, and they stayed on as bees. So there is an Uttarayanam and a Dakshinayanam. In the middle they will shift. The beehive will shift from the left to the right. But it continuously exists even now. So in that Suramaya Madhumakshika Raditam, so we are seeing the same bees that Dikshitar also must have seen. Their descendants, so to speak. And so he goes around like this. Now in 1831-32, Sharaboji is dying. And after that it is very clear that the East India Company is going to take over the kingdom. Musical patronage is not going to be the same. The boys are going to leave as well, the four, the Tanjavur quartet are ready to go. They are going to go to Swati Tirunal in Travancore. So what is going to keep Muthuswami Dikshitar in Tanjavur? Nothing much. So his two brothers, they go first and they go to Madurai, saying that they will get patronage from kings and nobles in Madurai. After some time, Muthuswami Dikshitar gets to know that his middle brother Chinnaswami Dikshitar has passed away, and that Baluswami, out of dejection, has gone to Rameshwaram. So he gets very anxious and he sets out in search of his brother. Ironically, during this time of depression for Dikshitar, some of his finest compositions make themselves manifest. So he goes to Trichy, where he composes Ranganayakam. Then Shri Matribhutam, Vaishya Jati Stri Veshadharanam, Chetti Pennukku Vandu Thayaraga Vandadu. Thayumanava Swami, God comes as the mother of a Chettiar lady to help her during delivery. And then Soma Sakam Natasuka, Somam Shirodhrita Surya Gangam. That is the only temple where Surya is on Shiva and not Chandra. Swami there is called Surya Shekhara. And then Suvasita Navajavanti Pushpa. Swami there is known as Javantinathar even now. So these are all those little details that he brings in. Then he goes to Kulikkarai, where he composes Neelakantham Bhajeham. He composes on Srirangam temple. Then he goes to my favorite shrine, Thiruvatpoki. You have to climb 1,000 steps to go up to the top of the temple. And you have to struggle through fighting monkeys to go there. They will ensure that you go up barehanded and come down barehanded. This Dikshitar has gone with his Veena and all his disciples, and they have climbed up those 1,000 steps. When you go there, you find the goddess standing in a sanctum by herself. She goes by the beautiful name of Aralakesi. And the Swami there is Ratnagirishwarar. Just him and the goddess, there is nobody else there. And a priest who comes in the middle of the day. In the last line of that song, Pahimam Ratnachala Nayaka, he says, Adhyapyarya Vamshajati Turiyajata Brihat Akandakaveri. There is this family brings water from the Akandakaveri every day. Adhyapya, even now, they are bringing the water every day for your Abhishekam. That is what he mentions in that song. So the Kaveri is 8 kilometers from the base of the hill. people bring. So I went up the top and then I asked the priest. He said, of course, it is still a tradition. You will see it in a few minutes from now. I find a couple of men bringing a huge kopare up the hill. They have walked all the way, those 8 kilometers. Every day that tradition is continuing even now in that temple. Then I was moved to tears and he said, Yadukku sir, I told him that this is what it is. He said, Dikshitar ezhuthinaarnu solren appare ezhuthirukkaare. So from the 7th century, this tradition is continuing in that particular temple. So he's gone to Ratnagirishwarar as well, goes to Madurai, and then he doesn't hear any further news about his brothers, so he is worried. Then he goes further south. Coming to a place called Sattur, he hears a group of Vaishnavite priests discussing a wedding that is to be organized by the Raja of Etayapuram. And having overheard the conversation, he finds that the wedding is for a musician called Baluswami who plays the fiddle and who has impressed the king by playing the fiddle. The fiddle was a novelty. Suddenly this man comes and plays it, king is very happy. So he is delighted and out of joy he composes a song in Megharanji, Venkateshwara Yedappa Bhupati Mashreyeham, where he also adds a line, Kanchana Vrishti Prada Megharanjita Bahukshetram. Kanchana Vrishti means a shower of gold. And he, out of gratitude for the king, for what he has done to his brother. So the priests take Muthuswami Dikshitar to Etayapuram. On the way, the region is completely arid. Moved by that, he creates a raga, Amrita Varshini, and composes Ananda Amrita Karshini. And it rains. He reaches Etayapuram, where he witnesses the wedding of his brother. Leaving behind his first wife to take care of the family, he comes back to Tiruvarur and spends some time in Tiruvarur. And as Subrahma Dikshitar beautifully writes, there comes a day when he realizes that he is not going to live for very long. And having taken leave of all his friends and telling them that he was not going to come back, he goes back to Etayapuram, where he passes away on Tula Krishna Chaturdashi, October 21st, 1835. The same year that he was born, he died. 60 years he had lived. Manmatha Varsham. He passed away on that day. He was cremated in Etayapuram. He has left behind this wonderful corpus of songs for us to delight in. And that makes him immortal. If that is not enough, within those songs he has left behind such wonderful lyrics for us to delight in. If that is not enough, he wants us to go and visit all those temples where he has sung, thereby keeping the temple tradition alive. So that, in a nutshell, is Muthuswami Dikshitar for you. Thank you very much.
I think there could have been a more comprehensive and more delightful introduction of the phenomenal Sri Muthuswami Dikshitar than what Sri Ram did. Thank you so much. And he also, of course, managed to send a, chill down my spine when he reminded us of Srinathadi Guru Guho Jayati Jayati, his very first composition. Such a brilliant piece, immensely complex composition. I mean, if you just imagine Dikshitar, he was probably 20 or something at the time, bursting forth spontaneously into such a composition, it really sends a chill down my spine. So I'm sure it does the same. I'm also told by Lady Wildness that this year marks the 200th year of the introduction of the violin to Carnatic music by Sriram mentioned, by Balaswami Dikshitar, but obviously under the guidance of his more illustrious elder brother, I would imagine. Right. So this is the 200th year of the violin in Carnatic music. So with that, thanks very much again, Sriram. And I also thank Sri LVS Garu immensely for taking time off his very hectic schedules. As you all know, currently Andhra Pradesh is that much more, busy in all the bifurcation and all those things, and he's still taken time off to come over here to spend a day with us. Thank you very much indeed. And we will now move on to the concerts. Please stay back. I request one small request for all of you. Please ensure your mobile phones are in silent mode. We're recording the proceedings and I would like to avoid any disturbance. And please stay back. We have coffee, tea and all that stuff through the day. And there is lunch also at about 1 o'clock.